Well, it's really great to be here and to meet you all once again. You know, we've certainly been in this old hall many, many times. And, well, I often get talking backstage to a lot of the fellas about some of the old days. And we'd like to do now just a short medley of some of the songs that have stood out on the old recording career. And I started recording commercially anyway. I did some private records in the mid-40s, but I started recording commercially in 1946. I went to town with my brother, and he was a bit upset, you know, because I wanted to wear a pair of high-heeled boots to town. He said, God's truth, everyone will stare at us. But today, no one takes much notice. Here's just a short medley of some of the old songs. This one I did first, the first song I had released on the Regal Telephone label, the old 78. And it goes something like this. Let me wander north to the homestead, way out further on there to roam. By a gully in flood, let me linger when the summery sunshine has flown. Where the logs tangle up on the creek beds and clouds veil the old northern sky, and the cattle move back from the lowlands when the rain tumbles down in July. The sleeping gums on the hillside awaken to herd scream by. For on the flats where the fences have vanished, as the storm clouds gather on high, the wheels of the wagon stop turning, the stock horse is turned out to stray. The old station dogs are a-dozing on the husks in the barn through the day. The drover draws rein by the river, and it's years since he's seen it so high. Yes, and that's just a story of homeward when the rain tumbles down in July. Hey! Here's a piece now, written about one of our very famous stockmen, one of the most famous of them all, man from Snowy River. There was movement at the station, for the word had passed around. The colt from old regret had gone away and had joined the wild bush horses. He was worth £1,000, so all the cracks had gathered to the fray. And Clancy of the Overflow came down to lend a hand. No better horseman ever held the reins, and never horse could throw him while the saddle girths would stand. And he learned to ride while droving on the plains. But one was there, a stripling, on a small and weedy beast. He was something like a racehorse undersized, with a touch of time or pony, three parts thoroughbred at least, and such as are by mountain horsemen prized. He was hard and tough and wiry, just the sort that won't say die. There was courage in his quick, impatient tread, and he bore the badge of gainness in his bright and fiery eye, with the proud and lofty carriage of his head. But still so slight and weedy, one would doubt his powers to stay. And the old man said, that horse will never do. With a long and tiring gallop, lad, you'd better stop away, for those hills are far too rough for such as you. But he waited sad and wistful, only Clancy stood his friend. Oh, I think we ought to let him come, he said, and I warrant he'll be with us when he's wandered at the end. For both his horse and he are mountain bred. Down by Kosciuszko, where the pine-clad ridges raise their torn and rugged battlements on high, where the air is clear as crystal and the white stars fairly blaze at midnight in the cold and frosty sky,
And where around the overflow the reed beds sweep and sway to the breezes and the rolling plains are wide. And the man from Snowy River is a household word today, and stockmen tell the story of his ride. Yes, stockmen tell the story of his ride, and stockmen tell the story of his ride. Thank you very much. Here's a bit of Australiana. Bit of substance in this one. Story about a character we call the Drover's Cook. Yeah, the Drover's Cook weighed 15 stone and he had one bloodshot eye. He had no laces in his boots and no buttons on his fly. His pants hung loosely round his hips, hitched by a piece of wire, and they concertinaed round his boots in a way that you'd admire. Now he stuck the billy on the boil and then emptied out his pipe, and with his greasy shirt sleeve he gave his nose a wipe. And with pipe in mouth he mixed the sod and drip hung from his chin, and as he mixed the damper up, the drip kept dripping in. I walked quietly over to him and I said, toss that mixture out, and in future when you're working, keep that pipe out of your mouth. Oh, he stood erect and eyed me with such a dirty look, and he said in choice Australian, get another bloody cook. Hey!